great to see you all, and welcome to this Angel session. My name is Liam Wegamont, and I'm the director of GEAN. For those of you who don't know GEAN, GEAN is the European network of ministries and agencies with national responsibility for global education. As you may know, GEAN was involved in the founding of Angel a few years ago in order to form bridges between policymakers, academic researchers, and also to have an effect through policy research on practice. We have a really interesting session ahead of us where we will be, I hope, hearing some exciting questions and theories about something in regard to paradigm shift in global education. And now to our speakers today. Jan van Ongevel works for the Institute for Work and Society Research, KU University in Louvain, and he leads the research group on global development. So without further ado, I hand over to Jan. Jan.
So in the coming 30 to 40 minutes, I will talk a little bit about evolving narratives in international development and how that is linked to the ongoing shift from development education to global citizenship education. So I will briefly talk a little bit about some of those narratives, and then I will delve into three practical implications for global citizenship education. Right, so let me start. And just as a way of starting, since I've been involved in learning about global issues and development, which is now over the last 15 to 20 years, I've always been, and I continue to be, intrigued by the difficulty of clearly pinpointing what learning about global issues and development actually is and what it entails. And of course, it's linked to the fact that it's a growing and a very dynamic educational discipline that is also known under many different terms, development education, global learning, global citizenship education, education for sustainable development, peace education, and so on, and many others. And there's also many actors that are involved. I definitely don't want to be exhaustive, but just a few examples: development NGOs, schools, colleges, youth organizations, social cultural organizations, local authorities, individuals, even social movements, trade unions, and so on. And then on top of that, it comes with many different approaches, which are linked to specific ideological visions and perspectives. Some authors differentiate between a charity perspective, an economic development perspective, global justice perspective. Some refer to soft and critical approaches. Some differentiate between normative and emancipatory approaches. Some refer to neoliberal, liberal, even critical and post-critical paradigms. So now, dealing with this complexity, of course, to deal with it, it's very useful to have some typologies that help you to group, to structure some of those perspectives, so that you can use them as conceptual frameworks that can inform practice. And today, I would like to just talk a little bit about this typology here that differentiates between a charity perspective, an economic development perspective, and a global justice perspective. And I find it very useful, this typology, and these various perspectives, you also will find them in different approaches within international development cooperation. Of course, those perspectives, they have not emerged neatly one after the other. They actually have coexisted over many years, and they still continue to coexist today. But interestingly, there's kind of a shift towards global justice perspective, which also resonates with the ongoing shift from development education to global citizenship education. So let me just briefly, quickly explain the three perspectives. First of all, the charity perspective. And within a charity perspective, it's assumed that global justice can be achieved by helping people in need through concrete individual action. Yeah, and it often comes with addressing problems, but without really surfacing and tackling the underlying structural causes of those problems. And you find a charity perspective very often in all kinds of fundraising activities, which seek to benefit a charitable cause, very often in countries in the global south, and particularly in actions that try to arouse or stimulate a feeling of kind of compassion by showing emergency situations or circumstances of poverty. And interestingly as well, the focus is very often on the people that give, the organizations that give, more than the people that are actually facing the injustice. Yeah? Of course, there's a lot of criticism on the charity perspective. For example, because of the stereotyping depiction of people as being needy, as being victims, but also because of the lack of deep analysis and addressing those structural causes of the problems or of the injustices they try to address. Now, an economic development perspective, on the other hand, that one looks at global development, often based on a Western model, neoliberal model, as an important solution for global challenges. And there, there's a lot of focus on supporting local actors to take control of their own economic development. However, it comes with a kind of a paternalistic view that the technical know-how has to be provided by the industrialized countries. And this perspective, and there's a lot of trust in belief in economic growth. And we talk here in terms of development cooperation instead of international development aid, which is more connected to the charity perspective. Now, development education from an economic development perspective, you find it in interventions that provide information about development programs implemented by development actors and the communities they support. But again, it's also critiqued for various reasons. For example, one of the critique is that it kind of assumes that universal scientific Western-based knowledge moves in one direction from the global north to the global south. It also critiqued for kind of continuing a server-served dichotomy, the ones who know and then the ones who don't know at the other end. And it's also critiqued by the fact that as information about economic growth and economic development is provided, it's not questioning actually the structural causes of some of the injustices and some of the global problems that are actually often caused by the economic models that are implemented. And then I get to the global justice perspective, which actually opposes the north-south divide. Yeah? It puts much more focus on the interconnection between the local and the global, the way the daily activities at local level can actually have an influence on global challenges and vice versa. It also looks much more at the structural causes of global challenges and injustices, and also questioning our role in it, in those challenges. And it does that from this perspective by bringing the learners or the target groups in contact with the various ideologies or the political economy systems that kind of create and perpetuate those global challenges. Also questioning our possible role in it and our possible co-responsibility in it, which is interesting because it actually also puts focus on people or actors who actually are in a privileged situation, making them aware about that privileged position and also making them aware about the consequences of their actions, behavior, activities that they have towards global challenges. Of course, that can be that brings in power relations, and that can be quite confrontational and uncomfortable, because suddenly you might realize that you're actually complicit in the global challenges that you are so-called trying to address. And it can also open up kind of, or it can question the deep-rooted worldviews that you have, that you use to look at the world, and might start help you start questioning them and maybe explore new ways of looking at the world. Now, you can see beneath the slides, you have a continuum there with on the one side soft, normative, and on the other side critical and emancipatory. And you can see that I've positioned the global justice perspective towards the critical and the emancipatory side, because of course here from a global justice perspective, you don't bring in solutions in advance. So it's not like normative. It's you actually try to empower learners to look for their own solutions together. And it's in the critical area because you really go and delve into the structural causes of the injustice, as compared to the other side of the continuum, where you have the charity perspective and economic development perspective, much more linked to a soft approach, feel good activities, not too much worrying or pulling people, learners out of their comfort zones. Also a bit normative, where already solutions are kind of predetermined. And you find that, you still find a lot of activities which are more linked to the left than to the right, because it's quite a challenge, both for the learners as for the people who facilitate the learning. Yeah. Okay, now let me go to some of the practical implications. Oh, I forgot the eyes. The eyes there is that you maybe it helps you to see the world in different ways. Yeah. Okay. Now, just some implications of practice when you try to work from a global justice perspective. And I said we see a shift towards a global justice perspective. We see that quite a lot in the literature, but we also see it in the practice, in the research that we are doing in Belgium, and I also see it in other countries happening. I'm going to focus on three practical implications, which I personally find very exciting and very interesting. And there's still a bit of work to be done. One is dealing with multi-perspectivity, which we just finished the research on. The second one, operationalizing the SDG principles, and three, planning, monitoring, and evaluation. Yeah. What does that mean what are the implications if you work from a global justice perspective? Okay, let me start with the first one, towards multi-perspectivity. Now, if you work from a global justice perspective, it's of course increasingly important to bring in multiple perspectives and operationalize the concept of multi-perspectivity. And why is that important? Well, it's important because from a global justice perspective, as I said, you don't want to impose one single mindset. You don't want to present one single vision of the future. It's open. It's about exploring possible solutions for the future, which is not easy because the learning process might actually cause more confusion then give more answers. So that's one. And a second reason is that from a global justice perspective, you're not going to approach the views. The idea is not to approach the perspectives of others from your own mind view, the way you interpret things, the way you look at the world. So it's not about learning about others. It's not learning from others with your mindset. Immediately, making conclusions from your own point of view. No, it's more related to what Steinert and colleagues in a publication of 2020 wrote as being taught by difference. And I found that very inspirational because it's like you learn from others, you're being taught by others so that you interact with others in a way that you are also changing your own worldview and perspective. And we just finalized research on multi-perspectivity, asking ourselves, how is it being implemented at the moment within Belgium? And by Belgium, development or global citizenship education actors. And we saw that an inquiry-based learning approaches actually provide a very good learning environment for developing the necessary skills to make that being taught by difference happen. We are talking about being able to go in dialogue, critical thinking, being able to really listening to the perspective of others and listening to the importance that someone gives to a certain perspective and understanding the perspective of another and the importance that is given to that perspective. And then using that knowledge to, together with the others, try to find solutions, work towards solutions. And we call that, which is a very interesting concept from very often used in religious education as well, from Edwards, it's a publication of 2017 that relates to relational agency, which is about working alongside others on complex problems and interestingly towards negotiated outcomes. So you work towards outcomes together, but not in a paternalistic way as equals, over a longer period of time towards a common problem or a common objective. And there we saw that some organizations are already starting to do that more and more in terms of global citizenship education, working on collaborative action research, for example, involving schools, but not just teachers, but the whole school team and the community to work towards, for example, the integration of children's rights within the schooling system, or working on food in the schooling system, action-oriented projects involving different stakeholders. But also, and that's the last thing, we see a very interesting shift in the work of organizations working on global citizenship education, whereby the education component, which is often development education or global citizenship education, and international development component, which is international programs and so on, and the lobby and advocacy component, which are in the past often different units within an organization, over the last few years, as we do evaluation research, we see them moving towards each other, which provides actually a very interesting and new learning environment to work together and to look for in a more structural way to work together towards those negotiated solutions. Right. A second practical implication is working or operationalizing the SDG framework, and not just working towards the SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals, but I'm talking about operationalizing the principles that underpin the SDG framework. And we just finalized a big research for the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and the DGD in Belgium, which was 2 years research on the Sustainable Development Goals. And we had some interesting discussions about the SDGs, where some were saying, yeah, it's a more neoliberal kind of framework. But I'm starting to realize that it's an internationally recognized framework that you can also try to operationalize from a global justice perspective. But let me just quickly show what that means. There are three key principles. The one is the indivisibility of the SDGs, which means that all the SDGs are kind of linked. So if you want to work towards certain SDGs, you have to consider the other SDGs. You have multi-stakeholder partnerships and the leave no one behind principle. Now, in terms of the indivisibility of the framework, if you look at it from a global justice perspective, it's actually a very good framework to approach certain global challenges from a systemic point of view, which is very useful if you want to work towards the structural causes of problems. Then it's not very useful to look at one goal, which we often do, though. We label our work and we say, oh, yeah, this work is kind of related to SDG 1 or SDG 2. But from this perspective, you would really look at it systemically and see the connections, which in practice would mean that as you are looking for negotiated solutions, you have to consider as much as possible co-benefits. For example, if you work in a certain area, is it going to have positive co-benefits on other goals or other areas? And maybe more important, look at negative trade-offs. If you're working towards one solution, is your solution, which might be wonderful in your perspective, is it not going to have negative effects on others? For example, if you're working towards the use of local products in a sustainability kind of thinking, in order to shorten the chain, the production chain and the provision chain, you might also need to ask yourself questions, is this not going to have negative effects for producers in other countries somewhere else in the world? Yeah? You see, those reflections are important from a global justice perspective. And I find that very useful. The leaving no one behind principle, that's about making sure that you don't leave out anyone, especially the most vulnerable. How, if you then think about your global citizenship education programs, it's also very useful because it really puts attention towards, or it wants you to pay attention to the structural causes why people are excluded. And that's exactly what global justice perspective wants you to do. Not just work at the surface, but look at the structural causes. And interestingly, from the leaving no one behind principle, if you develop your programs, or you look for solutions, you won't just look at what are the risks for our programs. No, you do it the reverse. You look at what is the risk of my program towards others. Are we not running the risk that with our activities we are excluding certain people? Yeah? Like a big challenge is that we always involving a kind of privileged learners in schools, and we miss out the difficult to reach groups, the youth that we are not reaching in the schools. So we need to go into partnerships maybe with other actors. What about stereotyping? Are we not damaging through our activities and reinforcing certain stereotypes, for example, and so on? Right, and that, of course, to make all that happen, you need new partnerships. The Bridge Network had a nice publication about it. You need more integrated strategic partnerships and also with new partners to work towards more ecosystems approaches. We need private sector actors. We need government actors. We need civil society actors. We need trade unions. We need to come together to work towards solutions for global challenges. If you want to learn more, you will find a little here, this one, click on it and you will get to a practical guide on all these things that I've just talked about. So that's the last one. The last implication, which is also, I find, a very interesting one, is, okay, what does this mean for planning, monitoring, and evaluation? If you work through a global citizenship education perspective, which we think we are moving towards, which we are seeing, there are three key things. And I have to mention that all these things that I'm talking about is based on research that we have been doing. And very recently, the Belgian government is actually in the process of revising its strategic note on development education. And it's going to be from development education, it's going to become a strategic note for global citizenship education. So all these findings hopefully will also inform the thinking about global citizenship education. And of course, one important one is how do we know things are working in the right direction? What is the effect of what we are doing? What is the impact of what we are doing? Whatever definition you want to give to it. Now, there are three important findings that I think are very helpful for working in a global justice perspective. And that is to realize that if you really want to work towards change, it's actors who are going to make change. It's people, it's organizations, it's institutions with actors in them. And actors can try to sustain certain structures or institutions, but they can also challenge them, they can question them in order to try to change them. So it's kind of important. We have learned over the years that to build your monitoring and evaluation system around actors. And then the concept of actor-focused theories of change. Forget about the definitions of output, outcome, output, whatever, input, impact. It's about clarifying who are the actors that you're going to try to influence, to work with, to support in order to get to, in order to develop, to work towards which outcomes, hopefully. Is it in terms of developing competencies? Is it in terms of developing new possible ways of thinking? That needs to be clarified. And also the idea of, you know, whatever theory of change you have, whatever plan you have, or whatever dream you have, and whatever pathway you think you have in order to work towards that dream, it's always incomplete. You will always need to learn along the way. So the theory of change that you develop will always need to be adjusted. So it's more of a process. It's not a product. It's a process that needs to be a basis for learning and to adjust. And that's where adaptive management comes in. And then a third one is that you need methodological diversity. There is no one method that will do the trick. It will be a mix of tools, and quantitative methods can be useful for some things, but definitely qualitative methods will also be needed in the mix. We just finished, you see the little drawing there in the left bottom corner. We just finalized a big impact evaluation of a youth engagement program in Belgium that ran over 3 years. We did a baseline, we did a midterm, we did an endline measurement. And I just want to briefly show a little bit of it. This is an actor-focused theory of change. It can look like this. It's where you really clarify with the actors involved what you're actually doing in terms of where is your control really? Where do you have control in terms of designing the activities and stuff? And who are the actors that you are hoping to influence? Who are you going to work with? And what are the outcomes you hope to see? It's very difficult to put smart indicators on that. You can't. I mean, you can, but it's not always very relevant because you don't know if what is going to happen in a global justice perspective. You don't even know the solution. You need to first develop skills in terms of competencies, maybe of critical thinking, and you never know if it's going to work anyhow. So you need a framework which clarifies what you hope to work towards, which might change in the process, and then use that framework with clear descriptions of hopeful outcomes. And probably a lot of expected stuff will come up to be able to learn from that. And to do that, you need a mix of methodologies. We used a mix of elements of outcome mapping, elements of contribution analysis, elements of a very small element of process tracing. We used survey research, we had interviews so that we could have lots of different data sources to triangulate, but not as an external, only as an external kind of evaluation. The experiment here was to really see, can these methods be used to not to prove if you have achieved what you said you were going to achieve, no, but to learn about your effects, to learn if this is going in the right direction, and then to make strategic kind of informed decisions about, are we happy with this? Are we not happy? Why are we not happy? Do we need to change things? Do we need to work with other actors? And so on, so that you can adapt. And this is where the interesting thing comes in. I'm going to stop here, Liam. I give the word back to you.
I just think two things from my side. One of the things we've always tried to do in the development of Angel is open up issues and questions for debate and discussion, rather than saying there's one solution or there's one way of looking at particular terms or concepts. And also you, and I think that's one of the things I think we've successfully done today. And I very much thank everyone for their contributions on that. And I think also we're also wanting to try and make some of the links that people are talking about today to some of the broader global issues that are currently taking place in the world. And again, I think there are some connections made to that. And then hopefully we will be able to take that forward in the future. I'd like to finally thank all the speakers, for Jan, Lasalette, and for Liam for chairing the session. And I hope everyone's enjoyed a very, I think, very stimulating and very important debate that I hope will continue in the weeks and months to come. Bye-bye. Thank you.